Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. You mean to wish me a good morning, or do you mean that it is a good morning whether I want it or not?
Please go away. Let me speak for the love of
You know, I thought you, when you told me this is what you're playing, I, in my head, it was Mbop.
Wow.
So, I'm pleasantly surprised.
Well, I mean, if anyone listening is good with 80s hair metal, then they'll know that the music is Unskinny Bop, and it's Unskinny is a perfect way to describe us.
I've been Unskinny all my life.
That's right. Welcome to Good Movie Monday, everybody, the show where we can't think of any other intro. I can't. I got nothing.
We don't really usually have anything.
No.
We just usually just ask me how I'm doing and...
Just come in with the flow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you mention, then somehow you weasel nerdy cinematic ramblings into there somewhere.
Okay, well, that is what we are. The podcast dedicated to nerdy cinematic ramblings. Here to kickstart your week as we do every single Monday.
And you are the host, Glenn Cochran, and I am your sidekick, Ben Helwig.
That's right, co-host I prefer.
Ah, right.
Yeah. We've been doing this for a few years now. You'd think we'd be better.
Yeah, you think. Well, you think every now and then I could be the host and you could be the co-host.
More than happy for you to do that. You just got to put your hat in the ring, mate.
Yeah, I'd have to bring a laptop. The only spare laptop I have is my porn laptop, and that cannot leave the house.
That's true. We don't want that connected to my Wi-Fi.
No, sir. It would taint.
Oh,
it'd be
Jesus.
Like it'd be like a nasty taint.
If you're a loyal listener and you enjoy what we do, there's a fuck ton of extra content over at goodmoviemonday.com. All of our episodes, all of our videos, some bonus content, all that kind of stuff. You can go back for years, even to the previous shows before Good Movie Monday. We've had like, I think, three other podcasts before this one. Go check them out. What else have we got? Interview. Every week on the show, we do an interview, or most weeks, we do an interview with somebody that makes movies. Usually they're directors, sometimes writers.
Sometimes actors.
Yep. This week, we have Jeff Wadlow. He is the director of, well, going backwards, he's the director of Truth or Dare and Cry Wolf and The Curse of Bridge Hollow, Fantasy Ooh. Island.
Cry Wolf. I did like Fantasy Island too.
Yeah, even Kick-Ass 2 and Never Back Down.
This guy, oh, I do. I like Never Back Down.
This guy's got some good movies to his name and his brand
Especially
new one.
Never Back Down 3. That's my favourite of the quadrilogy.
Which is the one with Dean Geyer?
That's 2.
2. Okay, that's, yeah. You know.
Yeah, but that's where Michael J. White enters it. Michael J. White is the... Because Michael J. White's the made-for-TV Digimon Hansu or whatever his name is.
Amistad Man. Yeah.
And then he carries through to number 3 when he has to teach more kids and he's like, I thought I was done with this shit. That's his version of I'm getting too old for this shit.
Yeah, totally. Well, anyway, Jeff Wadlow's new movie is Imaginary, the new Blumhouse movie about the teddy bear and... very, very fun. So we're going to talk about that. Stick around and listen to it. Ben, do you want to tell people what socials we have so that I can have a sip of my cuppa?
We've got the Instagram and the Facebook and the TikTok. What else have we got? We got the Spotify. We got the Threads. We got the Twitter. We don't use Threads or the Twitter too often. Mainly the Facebook and the Instagram.
We've got matching threads tonight.
We do have matching threads. Like and the Glenn loves his TikTok. I just peruse the TikTok.
It's a love-hate.
Glenn creates on TikTok.
It is a love-hate relationship with TikTok. I'm not a fan of the platform, but it does get us some good views. So
I've noticed that when I look at, when I perv on people on TikTok, well, you watch them, they talk to you, so you get to see who they are, like what kind of person they are on TikTok. Then you have to go to Instagram to see them in a bikini or something.
Yeah, click through to the spicy.
For the spicy content.
Yeah, a lot of mums do that, and that shocks me. That shocks me that there's mums doing it.
What an excellent way. I tell you what, I'd be mashing my pasty if I had one. What an excellent way to make some extra cash.
It is, but like for me, I can think, it's the same with tattoos, I think regret, future regret.
No. I'm not worried about the future. I wouldn't be worried so much about the future regret. What I'm worried about is like when you watch it, is the constant stream of content that you have to make. Like, who can be fucked? Like, they do those retarded videos, and I'm looking, you know, where they vox pops on the street, and you know, they're all doing the same, you know, they do the dances, but that's kind of gone out of fashion now. Like, the whole Charlie D'Amelio kind of thing has for the most part fallen by the wayside. They still do it every now and then because there's jiggling involved, but for the most part now it's like, you know, if there's a you know, some trend, they all have to do their version of it, like, you know, Barbara's rhubarb or whatever the lettuce thing is.
Do you know how many times I scroll through TikTok and just think, why? Like, why? This makes no sense. And I've seen it 100 times. Why are you doing this? But those spicy ones, I think to myself, those mums that do, and it's very spicy. It's like actual porn. It's not,
it is 100%
you know,
porn.
But it's like, aren't you worried your kids are going to find it one day? It's out there. It's not going anywhere.
Maybe they're doing it in front of their kids anyway.
Oh, fuck.
Like, you know, mummy's got to make some spicy content. Do you like your PlayStation 5? This is how mummy paid for it.
Don't eat that cucumber. I need it. Oh, my God.
You know.
Well, we do have our regular segments coming up, speaking of spicy stuff.
I think destigmatizing it is probably is what's going to be happening. It's like, if everyone's doing it, it's not going to be a thing anymore.
Yeah, things ebb and flow, though. I don't know. Trends come and go, and I don't know. All I think of is instant regret or future regret, but anyway. Yes, like I was saying, we have our spicy boneheads coming up.
Did you listen to their latest episode? Was Who's Going to Replace the Boneheads?
Yeah, I did. I watched it. It was interesting. I thought
I haven't seen it. Are they retiring? No. Is that what's happening?
No. Chad was not along for that episode. They had nothing planned, so that's sort of where the conversation just naturally led. And they went from Who's Going to Replace Chad to Who's Going to Replace all of them. But they went in, like, I'd be like, I guess you kind of, they know their audience better than we do, but I'd be thinking, like, go people we know, like, you know, oh, you know, Matt would be good to come into the show, and
yeah,
you know, maybe get Jared in and all this kind of stuff. But they went Hollywood, and they went, I think they did a couple of dead actors, and I'm like, you know.
Oh, so they didn't select us?
No.
That's upsetting.
That's the only reason I watched.
Yeah.
I thought, like, let's.
We'll just pass the baton to Bennis and Glennis.
We're going to have them on the show in a couple of weeks, and we're going to have to press them on that, I think.
Yeah.
I'm going to let them take over the show for a bit too.
That'll be interesting.
Yeah, see what happens. See what happens here. So stick around for that one. What else do we have coming up? We've got the Jarrett's PE class. Once again, Jarrett's not with us this week, but I think, Ben, you're going to step in. You did a great job last week, may I say.
Well, this week is a
different story.
Different story, because last week nothing came out. It was great. Only one thing.
Yeah.
This week, it is the mother load.
That's right.
It's a full Imprint Viavision madman cavalcade
clusterfuck
of titles, all of which have a boatload of extras.
Oh my goodness. Hey, one other thing too is this is the first episode of the month, and usually that's the episode that Malzie Begg joins us, and of course she's from the Melbourne Horror Film Society. She's not with us this week, and she normally spruiks their schedule, so I'm just going to quickly run through what they've got coming up. They've got two particularly fun screenings that you might want to get along to. These are sort of bi-monthly. One's at True North, and the other one is at Long Play. There are two sort of bars in the Melbourne area. At True North on the 13th, they have Adam Green's Frozen, which I love that film. That's the one on the ski chairlift.
Mm.
Great one location concept, really well made. Because I don't think Adam Green hasn't really made particularly great films since then. He's made okay ones, Hatchet and stuff like that.
I quite liked Hatchet, actually.
Yeah, it's okay.
But it's very... Yeah,
I mean, I love this guy. We're going to have him on the show soon. I have no doubt about it. So, yeah, all of his films are great. Hey, Adam, do you want to come on the show? Here, you know, go have a listen. Just don't go back too far, just to see what we're all about. Just, you know, 2 minutes will do you. Don't go any further. And at Long Play on the 30th, they have The House by the Cemetery. Another good one.
The Fulci film. I get them all mixed up, but I think that's the one where Giovanni Ribisi gets a drill to the head and...
Could be.
I think it's the one with the priest. Doesn't the priest kill himself at the start, and that's what opens the gates of hell?
Yes, I think you're right.
City of the Dead.
Oh, maybe it's that. It's part of that collection.
It's part of the three with the Beyond.
Yeah.
The Beyond, City of the Living Dead, and
I watched them about I watched them about 4 years ago. They have fun. I really like them.
Yeah.
So
back when Cinema Cult put them all out.
Yeah, and they're the one I've got the trilogy back from there.
Yeah.
So if you are into all of that, get along, go to melbournehorrorfilmsociety.org or their socials. join up and just, you know, have some fun and get along. It's a real good sort of horror community that you can be part of and watch some horror movies with like-minded people. Ben, let's talk about, before we push on to your takeover of the PE class, let's push on to some movies that we've watched this week. Have you watched much?
Well, I don't know where you're going with this.
So. Oh, well, we went to the cinemas together.
I was going
to
say, is that where you... Yeah.
Yeah, but before we get to that, I was just thinking, like, have you watched much? I watched I did Return of the Living Dead 1 and 2 back-to-back on the same night. It was fantastic.
Oh, look, I haven't seen Return of the Living Dead Part 2 in a very long time, like since I was a kid.
It holds up much better than I remember it holding up. I remember Tom Matthews has been on the record saying how much he hates it. Because him and the other bloke are in it together, almost playing the same characters but different, even though they... Spoiler alert, die in the first one.
Yeah, doesn't he? Yeah. He's like the one who can smell your brains and
stuff. Yeah, but they come back in part two as new characters, but they're the same kind of type.
Right. Is it him and the guy who the he works for?
Yeah. But anyway, look, I had a lot of fun with it. And I learnt, and apparently everyone else knew this and I didn't, that the version most of us know from DVD has a different soundtrack to the original theatrical. And if you go to the French audio track on that DVD, it's got the original soundtrack.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Oh, look, I've only for part one.
Part two.
Because I know there was a thing about some of the Cramp songs in part one.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah. No, this is a score as well as soundtrack.
Right.
I found a YouTube video going a deep dive into it, why this happened, and you know it's not the reason a lot of people think it is, and. It's an oversight more than a legality.
Right.
And then I posted that I'm watching them on my Facebook, and one of our listeners, Justine Ryan from Cinemaniacs, she goes, "Oh, which version did you watch?" You know, and I'm like, "Oh, okay. Well, I'm not new to this."
I don't know.
Apparently, everybody knows. No, I definitely watched because I think it was whoever in the States put it out on Blu-ray restored the original theatrical soundtrack.
Would it have been Shout Factory?
Maybe? Might have been. I think they've restored it to its original glory.
Because the last one I watched was part three.
Which is a good one.
Which is, but it's a very different beast from one and two.
Yeah, very loosely connected. It is a very different kind of film. It's very much a Brian Yuzna film.
But I think it actually makes a pretty good companion piece to something like the Abel Ferrara Body Snatchers movie.
Yeah, sure.
It's that kind of military kid who discovers,
yeah,
you know, shit going on and kind of stuff happens.
I can see that.
But I really have a lot of time for the first one. Mm-hmm. But I keep meaning to watch the second one. But does it actually, it doesn't actually pick up from the, it's not like they've dropped the bomb and destroyed which is what they kind of allude to at the end of part one.
What I like most about part two is that it's, much like The Gate and Gremlins, it's kids that are the central characters. They're the heroes of it, right? And little kids, like 9, 10. And they come across a barrel of that stuff.
Yeah.
And it's supposedly the same stuff from the first movie. So it is the same universe, different area.
Send more caps.
Anyway, I watch those.
Also watch some other films, which I don't know if one of them you're going to recommend, but you did end up watching, you had a great triple feature on the weekend. Dead Bang, Presumed Innocent.
Yes.
And what was the third one?
Dead Bang, Presumed Innocent, and...
Or is it Presumed... No, Innocent Man.
And Shoot to Kill.
Shoot to Kill. Was it Innocent Man?
Innocent Man.
Selleck one.
Yeah.
Which is great. The one where he's in the prison, shanking people in the toilet.
With F. Murray Abraham, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love that movie.
That's great. Because I used to always get it mixed up with... with what's the one with Pauline Pozakova, where she's the assassin?
I don't remember. But I love that you remembered I watched that trilogy and I completely forgot.
Forgot it. Because I always get those two mixed up, which that one's much more of a lighter comedy where he's a writer who's got writer's block and he hooks up with Pauline Pozakova. He falls in love with her. But then it turns out that she's like an international hitman, international assassin. And then there's this one, which is the hardcore prison movie, which is like possibly one of the most serious movies that Tom Selleck has ever done. Because after he became a star and got Magnum, it's like comedies from kind of there on out.
It's all quirky. It is a great movie. I've always loved it. But Dead Bang, you know I've got a real soft spot. And the more I watch it, the more it rises to my all-time favourites.
Yeah. So, I've only watched it once and I didn't like it as much as you do.
It. The more I watch it, the more I like it. And the more you watch it, the more you see how Christmas it is. Like, it is a real Christmas movie. And it just goes dark. Like, it goes to places that most action movies don't.
Yeah.
You know, because it's all about white supremacy. And oh, William Forsythe comes into it and he's just hilarious as the stuck-up fucking FBI agent.
Yeah.
I would appreciate it if you didn't use so many profanities in front of me. I find it offensive.
Which is very unlike him in everything else from, like, what's the Steven Seagal movie he's in? Nico Above the Law or one of those.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm pretty sure he's played white supremacists before.
He was flathead in the Dick Tracy.
Yeah, yeah.
In Dick Tracy. And he's...
Devil's Rejects, you know?
Is he Al Capone? Is he Frank Nitti in the Elliot Ness TV series with Robert Stack?
Uh-huh. There you go.
what's his name? Shoot to Kill. Not Shoot to Kill. What's it
Shoot
called?
To Kill's great, yeah.
What's the other title of that one, though?
Oh, Deadly Pursuit.
Deadly Pursuit, which is what I think I've...
Same movie, in case you're wondering what the fuck we're talking about. It's, in Australia it was called Deadly Pursuit. Everywhere else it was Shoot to Kill.
Shoot to Kill. With Sidney Poitier, Tom Berenger, Kirstie Alley, and Clancy Brown?
Clancy Brown, Richard Masur. It's just a really fucking great cast. And it's a wilderness survivalist film. Essentially, a serial killer joins a hiking group to escape the feds. And so the feds realize where he is. And Sidney Poitier plays the fed that joins up with a tracker, which is Tom Berenger, who's like a city slicker. Like, Sidney Poitier is a city slicker.
Yeah.
And they go into the wilderness Rambo style.
Because he's basically replaced one of the hikers and gone off with Kirstie Alley, who's kind of Tom Berenger's...
Love interest.
Yeah, it's kind of ex-love interest, love interest.
Very similar to Cliffhanger, really.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, totally. Yeah. And I'm pretty sure that MacGyver ripped off the plot in an episode.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah, I've always loved Deadly Pursuit. Like, it is a real thrilling kind of movie. And I remember when I moved to Canada, the first thing I did was try and find those locations.
Because for a long time, it was unavailable here. Like, it came out on VHS and then it just disappeared. Yeah.
Exactly. So I snapped up that DVD from America when I could. But
anyway,
we also got to the cinemas.
We did.
Last week, and we saw A Quiet Place Day One.
We did.
And I liked it. I did. I liked it a lot. I'm really enjoying this franchise, and it is definitely becoming a franchise. It's the world building, I think, is really good. And I said to you, this to me is what Cloverfield should have been, rather than going scattered across different kind of settings and locations.
Yeah. I think
one sticks to the theme.
Yeah. I mean, look, unless they start just going to other countries, the franchise is kind of done, because once you figure out the
Quiet Place? I think there's a lot more, and I think that's what they'll do is they will go to different parts of America before they go international.
Yeah. But they're all going to be prequels to part two. Because part two, like, unless something happens where they become impervious to the sound, then you know, it's like War of the Worlds. It's like once the aliens get sick of the cold and all start dying, you can't really do War of the Worlds part two.
Yeah.
Because I suppose they could do War of the Worlds Part 2, The Immunity, or The Vaccine, where they've all been vaccinated and they come back and now they're all doped up on penicillin.
I guess you could go forward in story and, like, maybe even the aliens have died out, but it's like, what does humanity do now? Like, how do we come back?
Come back from it. Yeah. I mean, look, that would be, I love that stuff.
Yep.
I don't know if they would, I mean, I'd love Roland Emmerich to do that movie of, like, you know, the recovery. You know, like, I thought the most interesting thing about the last Avengers movie was the part that they skipped through, the 5 years after, you know, which is basically what The Leftovers is about.
Yeah.
You know, that period of time where half the people have disappeared, 50% of the, and you just have to, like, all right, now what do we do? Like, that's what I loved about The Stand. Like, I could have foregone all of the stuff in Vegas with The Stand. And it just been about them meeting each other and trying to rescue the town and survive.
Mm-hmm.
Not on, you know, because at some point canned food and all that sort of stuff is going to go out.
Mm-hmm.
They've got to, you know, find animals and learn animal husbandry and learn, you know, process, you know, mass production processing and how to keep electricity going and all that sort of stuff, which they just kind of gloss over. But that, to me, is the interesting stuff.
Yeah. You know, this is funny. The Quiet Place one, I think it's based on the premise of the second film. The very start of the second film shows day one in a small town when the aliens first strike. And I think that actually did it more effectively, because that was a really terrifying intro.
Yeah.
But I like the cityscape of this one, putting it in New York City. Obviously, you kind of, you know, have, it's a bit of a metaphor to, you know, post, you know, 9/11 and the city's still under, you know, trauma. Well,
because that's the first kind of incursion.
Mm.
It's basically the dust is everywhere, so you can't see.
Yeah.
You don't get, even though we as an audience know what they are because we've seen the previous two films, but they can't see anything. It's just these things tearing them out of the darkness.
Yes, but that also opens it up to some problematic issues, which we talked about, and you kind of do have to really suspend your disbelief in this one a little bit because...
I think in the whole franchise.
Yeah, but at least in like... So what I'm getting at here is you see the aliens very much in this one, and obviously they are blind and they've got ultrasonic hearing, right? And a penny drops, they're onto it, and yet... They're blind and they have the ability to scale buildings with precision, leap onto particular points, you know, on a car or whatever, like with precision.
Yeah.
And as you pointed out, and yet they're not susceptible to each other's noises.
Yeah.
You know, because everywhere they go, they're making noises when they hit the rubble. And
they run.
Smash windows.
Their footsteps are much louder than the people's when they're running and around and doing stuff.
So therefore, like at least with part one and two, we didn't see them. They're in the shadows. They're in the dark, you know, so it didn't matter as much. And you didn't have to suspend your disbelief too hard. This one you definitely do.
Yeah.
You know, unless they're going to make another installment and explain how that happens.
Yeah. But look, it's one of those ones where you're like, I know that this is an issue, but I don't care.
Nah,
I
mean, exactly. Fun. Exactly.
It's fun enough.
And if that's the only negative you can go to, you know, that's still a pretty good movie because it doesn't matter whatsoever because you're focused on these human characters. That, mind you, the lead character in this one shit me all the way through this movie. It really did. I don't want to give too much away, but I didn't like her story.
It just seems like of all the things that you can do, like I guess, you know, it's like writing wank. It was just unnecessary. Like it could have been like you'd. Why not just make it about Digimon Hansu?
I'm a starred man.
Why not just make it about him?
Yeah, because they introduce him in this, and he's obviously from part two, so we've got a little bit of an origin story for him. But I mean, it doesn't really connect the dots there for part two. But anyway, look, a good third installment, I think, to this series. I'm quite happy with where this is going. And once upon a time. By the time you got to three, it was that whole rule of diminished returns, right? With the sequel, you know, they put less money into it. It made less money. This one, I think, will make a lot of money, and they've clearly put a lot into it.
Yeah. I'm just looking up here. How do I...
what?
It is... Yeah, Jimon Hounsou.
Yeah.
Yeah. I always say Digimon because maybe the D is silent.
I had to, when I was writing up my review for this, I did accidentally spell it Digimon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Digimon.
I mean, I corrected it before it got published, but of course, you know, Digimon just made sense to me. Anyway, so we saw that. I also caught the new Indian film Kill, which is essentially John Wick on a train, Indian style, almost Bollywood. It's got a very melodramatic bookend.
Sounds like Jarman.
Jarman, okay.
That's what it says. That's what the British pronunciation says. Sounds like Jai Mun.
Okay, excellent. So we're making sure that you're all informed and you don't have the wrong information.
Because Jai Mun Hansu.
If there's one thing that we can do on this show, it's mispronounce names.
Very
well. I saw the movie Kill, which is like a Bollywood version of John Wick on a train. Bullet train meets John Wick. Full on action.
You were very excited to see this.
I was. It's full on action, but it's a silly movie. The melodrama just really ruined it for me, and it's that Bollywood melodrama too.
Yeah.
So you know, really, really heightened. Lots of head wobbling. That's what happens,
in
a Bollywood movie, and when you put that into an action movie, it's kind of weird. What else do I have to say?
They're dodging bullets, Matrix style,
and the intro scene, like the first scene of the movie, well, it's all one scene really, the movie, but the opening credit shot is at the 50-minute mark.
Yeah.
You get 50 minutes of movie and then it's like, kill! And then you've got a whole lot more movie. Where
I think that's like, there's a lot of directors out there who do like a late credit sequence, but that's taken the piss.
That's really taken
Look,
the piss.
The reason I couldn't be bothered, apart from the fact that it's at Melbourne Central, which you know I don't like to go to.
Uh-huh.
And the movie, I don't think gets a proper release for a little while. I don't think it's this week.
I think it's a week after,
or something, yeah. So there's still time to catch it at Chatty. But I find these movies, like I really struggle with the John Wick movies.
Oh, same here.
Post the first one.
Yep.
Because it's just...
monotonous.
It's just a monotonous long... Like for me, the most interesting things in action movies are the bits in between that like I do want the cathartic payoff of the action.
Yeah.
But in order for that to be a cathartic payoff of action, you need a reason to hate them and to want to see that stuff happen.
Yeah.
And if you take that away where it's just there's, you know, because otherwise it feels like, you know, the Austin Powers joke about, you know, no one ever thinks about the henchmen. Like there's just, you know, this guy goes through 100 dudes who are just, I just turn up to work today. Like, yes, my boss is an evil...
Actually, that reminds me of the one thing that really bothered me in this movie, and it just made me shake my head the whole time, is you've got these bad guys that hop on this train, and they are butchering people, right? Like, they are killing people left, right, and center in the most horrific ways, and yet the second one of them is killed, it's like, why? And they look at the other guy and go, why did you kill my... You know? It's like, because you fucking killed everybody, like, you know... Yeah. I just love how sorry they feel for themselves.
Look, that's my favorite thing about bad guys in every movie, where they're so upset. Like the whole Patriot Games is all fueled on how could you kill my little brother when he, you know, tried to kill the prince of the. In the book, it's the Prince of Wales, but in the movie, it's like the Earl with a machine gun in the middle of London while taking out a bunch of taxi drivers and innocent people.
This happened. How dare you? All the way through the movie, and it felt like by the end they are taking the piss. Like, you know, this is clearly, you know, it's a weird movie. I think it'll do well on streaming on platforms.
Yeah.
But anyway, there we go.
Jesus Christ, Glenn! It is a massive, massive week.
Big fat one.
Of pig class of physical releases this week. I do wish that Jarrett was here for this one.
I don't envy you.
Because it's outrageous.
Mm, so we can whiz through them, maybe stop on a couple of, you know, tent.
No. I've done a lot of work writing all this stuff out.
Strap in. You're in for the long haul.
This took a long time.
I need another drink. Okay.
So first up, the good people at Sony are releasing Ghostbusters Frozen Empire is coming out. DVD, Blu-ray, and 4K.
I seem to like this more than everybody else.
Yeah, look, I enjoyed it while I was kind of watching it, but yeah, I don't know. If this is, I couldn't find any information about what the extra features are in the local one. The US version comes with like deleted scenes, 7 featurettes, and a commentary by the director, co-writer, Gil Keenan.
Yep.
So that's looking pretty good. It's, you know, it's got all the. I didn't actually check if it has Dolby Atmos. I'm assuming it does.
Probably.
But it's looking pretty special. If you're into it, the big company of who've released a boatload of stuff this week is the good folks at ViaVision, who we wish would support the show by throwing me a couple of copies of things. So let's go through. It's a ViaVision, just ViaVision. They're releasing Railway Man on Blu-ray. Mm-hmm. It comes with an audio commentary by director Jonathan Debzicki and co-writer producer Andy Patterson, as well as a making of featurette. It seems to be the first time this movie's come out on Blu-ray locally, but I feel like the movie's a couple of years old. It's Colin Firth, Nicole Kidman. I remember it playing it.
I'm pretty sure it's had a Blu-ray release because
so
I
maybe
I
this is just they've just picked it up
shelves,
as a second release.
Yep.
In TV shows, because I'll say Imprint will be next, and Imprint's where all the money is. But they're releasing the Jensen Code. Like Imprint have picked up a bunch of the ITV TV series from the UK that previously Network had released in the UK, but Network has since gone bust.
Right,
and so all those shows are now impossible to get. When I went to the UK last year, I bought back a suitcase full of ITV Network DVDs, but thankfully the ones I missed are coming out locally thanks to the good folks at ViaVision. So I'm very excited about the Jensen Code. It's like a 70s sci-fi kids thriller. Like they're all kids series from the 70s and 80s. They're great. But so the first big Imprint release this week is the After Dark. I think it's volume 4 of the After Dark neo-noir cinema. This one contains Homicide, which is a David Mamet movie, which I think is one of the few that I didn't really get into when I watch it on VHS. I'm keen to give it a rewatch.
I don't mind it at all. I'm really keen to watch it again.
Stars Joe Montana as a Jew, which I find funny. But you know, once you're a What's if you're a an Jew? Ethnic if you're an ethnic, you can play any kind of ethnic.
Mm-hmm.
But it does contain a new audio commentary by film historian Jim Hempel and a theatrical trailer. Also in the box is White Sands, the Willem Dafoe movie, which has a new audio commentary by DOP Peter Menzies and Roger Donaldson, the director, moderated by Gillian Wallace Horvat. That's a new one. New Heart and Soul editor Nicholas Bowman sifts through White Sands. And new High New Noir writer Daniel Pine on White Sands featurette. There's also a theatrical trailer. Crossing Guard is also on this box set.
Sean Penn
one. And this one it does actually contain the original audio commentary by Sean Penn, Angelic Houston, and David Morse.
Have ViaVision put out The Pledge? Because that's one I would love to get a reissue of.
No, I don't know, actually.
Yeah.
I seem to recall that coming out, though.
Like what about a Sean Penn box set with like the ones he's directed? That'd be fantastic.
That'd be great. There's a new audio commentary by Travis Wood. New Purging Vulnerability writer-director Sean Penn navigates emotional territory of The Crossing Guard. That's new. How'd they get Sean Penn? Emotionally exposed actor Priscilla Barnes on Vernon, one of your favorites. I know Priscilla Barnes. New Changing Ways editor Jay Cassidy on The Crossing Guard. Rebels Without Causes, Images of Masculinity in Sean Penn's The Crossing Guard by Kat Ellinger. Behind the scenes vintage featurette, theatrical trailer. Now, this one's interesting. Heaven's Prisoners.
Yep.
With the new audio commentary by the director Phil Durando. Now, this movie was famous because at the time Terry Hatcher was blowing up on Lois and Clark, The Adventures of Superman.
Yep.
And she did two films, Clean Surface and Heaven's Prisoners, both of which she got naked in. And they were major. That was where the major interest came from.
She was in good old Brain Smasher, the Albert Pune film.
She was in Brain Smasher, yeah. She's in a ton of stuff. She's in Tango and Cash, for Christ's sake. But yes. She broke in Lois and Clark. But it's got a bunch of extra features. Producer Andre Morgan remembers Heaven's Prisoners. Archival interviews with Alec Baldwin, Mary Stuart Masterson, Kelly Lynch, Terry Hatcher, Eric Roberts, and the director Phil Joannou. Additional archival interview with Terry Hatcher, behind the scenes. Promotional vintage featurette, theatrical trailer. There's also, the next film is Under Suspicion.
Uh-huh. Oh, that's an interesting one.
Yeah, that's
Stephen Hopkins, yeah?
Yeah. Mm. And that's got audio commentary with Stephen Hopkins and Morgan Freeman. I could just go to sleep listening to that.
Stephen Hopkins is a guy that came up through like Nightmare on Elm Street, and he did Predator 2, and he went on to make 24, the TV show. Like, this guy's got no one's heard of him, but he's got a lot
he's
of
like a journeyman director.
Him. Yeah.
Then the standout of the box set, which is Dirty Pretty Things.
Yes.
The Stephen Frears film. It features the archival audio commentary with Stephen Frears. It has a new interview with DOP Chris Menzies, and a behind-the-scenes vintage featurette.
Didn't you recommend that once on the show?
I think I actually, Rebecca, like I talked about it a couple of weeks ago, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely. Then we've got Fresh.
Oh, I love Fresh.
Not part of the box set. These are just the standalone releases.
I
the
love
five
this
movie. Of
this week. Yep. Great.
So Fresh has a boatload of extras. After going through all of those,
all right.
I'm just not going to get through
them.
It
was a big deal to me when that came out. I was very much into those Boys in the Hood urban type of movies, Clockers, you know.
Mm. I think this for me was the first movie that I was aware of Juan Carlo Esposito, who now is in fucking everything.
I know. His breakthrough came late in his career.
Yeah. Like he's just...
The average person just knows him from Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul, but then you look at his career and you're like, I've seen that. He's been in so many. He was in Do the Right Thing. He's the crazy guy with, you know, the hair.
Well, that's apparently he's actually Italian.
Yeah, right, well, it makes sense, the name.
Well, no, the name is like Latin. Like his father and stuff are like...
Yeah, you're
like,
right. It's
like they're like of Spanish Latino origin, but he was born in Italy. They moved to Italy. He was born there, and so speaks Italian.
Okay,
he's like I saw this interview with him going like, no one knew what to do with me or how to deal with me because my name's you know Juan Carlo.
Yeah,
but and I look Puerto Rican and I'm living in America, but I'm Italian. also coming out. This is a very special film in my. Adolescent Development, Rambling Rose, with Laura Dern and Robert Duvall and Lucas Haas. Mm-hmm. That's got a bunch of extras in it as well. Then there's the Secretary.
Yeah, overrated.
To be honest, I bought it when day one.
You bought it because of the cover.
No, I bought it because I was genuinely interested to see it. The cover certainly didn't hurt, and I always liked Maggie Gyllenhaal.
Yeah.
But I never actually bothered watching it, which is weird. And there was I've had issues with, like, not issues, but sometimes there are periods of my life where I've loved James Spader and periods of time where I've hated James Spader and don't want to watch any James Spader movies. And this was just happened to be during a down period.
Okay.
Also, they've got United States of Leland.
Yep.
Which I don't remember.
I do. I never saw it, but I do remember seeing the VHS of it.
Because I think it came out around the same time as like Last of the High Kings and stuff like that. So I just got them all kind of confused. But the big thing, and I know you'll be jazzed about this if you don't already have them on Blu-ray, but it's the Martin Scorsese Films of Faith box set.
It's a great box set.
It is each one of these movies is, I think, except for maybe Silence. Because it's Silence, Kundun, and Last Temptation of Christ, but they're all two discers.
Mm, yeah, it's a great collection. It's interesting because I was of the opinion, and I could be wrong, I thought he considered Bringing Out the Dead to be one of his faith films as well.
Look, I think I know that there's a big restoration of Bringing Out the Dead in the US. So I'm sure it depends on. This is just what.
Well, these, I mean, it would be the odd one out. It'd be the odd duck in the collection if it was in there because it's a different tone.
Yeah.
But it's very spiritual. But these ones are much more period piece, pilgrimage types, you know, they are. Yeah. And I think Silence was very underrated. I think that was a great film.
Yeah, and that's the only one that's a single disc. So that's interesting.
That was his passion project before The Irishman, which was his next passion project. And suddenly he's just making passion projects.
Yeah. Well, that's all he does now.
Yeah.
I want to make $200 million passion projects. Right. Why won't you let me just do what I want?
Don't you know who I am?
Yeah. Studio Canal has a couple of interesting DVD, Blu-ray, and 4Ks out this week. They've got Delicatessen.
Yeah, that's right.
Delicatessen and City of Lost Children, the two original Jean-Pierre Junot Marcaro.
Friend of the show, Jean-Pierre.
Yeah. And it's interesting because I think... I couldn't find anything about what the extras are in Delicatessen, but City of Lost Children, if it's the same, and usually Studio Canal do, the extras are pretty much the same on the Australian release. The discs are usually the same. It's just the outer packaging and stuff that's different. But it does have a commentary with Jean-Pierre Junot and Ron Perlman. So that's going to be interesting to listen to.
Well, Will, I had real trouble speaking to him because his English was really broken.
Bad, yeah.
And I mean, if he's doing a comment, does Ron Perlman speak French? That's the question.
Well, maybe it's got subtitles. Or maybe maybe it's like that perfect thing like in Ghost Dog where Forrest Whitaker doesn't speak French and I can't remember the guy's name who he meets in the park, the ice cream seller, who only speaks French, but they have a conversation. They both know what each other is saying, even though they don't actually understand the language. It's a really great scene. Maybe that's what the commentary is.
Maybe.
Ron Perlman's in English. Yeah. Jean-Pierre's in French, but they're just conversing. And they're also bringing out Peeping Tom, the Michael Powell film about the voyeur.
One of the early videotapes I ever purchased.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, and that was actually, I think, the first sell-through I ever purchased. Before that, it was all ex-rentals, so that was the first brand new tape.
Brand new tape, right. This one's full of extras. New Visions of Voyeurism, Peeping Tom by Sir Christopher Froehling. New York, Take Me to Your Cinema, The Legacy of Peeping Tom. New Restoring Peeping Tom from 2023 trailer. London Easter Egg, The Eye of the Beholder intro by Martin Scorsese. Interview with Thelma Schoonmaker, 2007. Audio commentary by Professor Ian Christie. Original theatrical trailer, behind the scenes... Stills Gallery. It is jam-packed.
And, of course, this is the movie Ben has modeled his life after.
That's right, without ever having seen it. Look, there's also Paramount are bringing out Forrest Gump on 4K.
Yep.
A lot of people will be happy about that.
I was only talking about Forrest Gump last night to my wife because we watched the new Robert Zemeckis trailer, that new movie Here, which looks fascinating. Have you watched that yet? The entire film takes place on the one location over millions of years.
Yeah.
Good concept, whether it works or not. But I just said to her, I said, do you recognize the husband and wife? She goes, well, yeah, it's Tom Hanks, and I know her from Princess Bride. I'm like, yeah, but come on.
Yeah.
Like,
Jenny. Look, Umbrella are releasing Lizard in a Woman's Skin on Blu-ray. I guess, what's the term for the purposes of public disclosure? I produced this disc for Umbrella. but it does contain new feature-length audio commentary with Howard Asperger and Troy Howarth, new Lucio Fulci, Lucio in a Woman's Skin, a video essay by the Flying Machista Brothers, a new one and 100 Fulcis, a visual essay by Howard Asperger and Francesco Masacchesi, new Dan Dangerous Roads, Kim Newman on Stanley Baker, which I edited.
Should have led with this title, mate.
Yeah.
Because, you know, those people that haven't persevered this far will never know.
No. Then there's a couple of archival extra features. Shedding the Skin, a documentary by Chris Gavin. When Worlds Collide, Stephen Thrower on A Lizard in a Woman's Skin. From Burton to Baker, an interview with actor Tony Adams. There's a Lucio Fulci trailer reel, worth checking out just for that. Alternate opening credits, trailers. It's jam-packed, and you can still get the special edition from the Umbrella web store. I highly recommend that. It comes with a fantastic... Because the movie was actually released originally in the US under a different title, yep. And we've used that original artwork as the rigid case art, which looks fantastic. And there's a couple of posters, some art cards,
Wicked.
A bunch of stuff on that one. So I definitely recommend that. And last but not least, this is something that I don't think Jarrett would mention because it is a filthy DVD.
This is the one benefit of not having Jarrett here. We can talk about filthy DVDs.
Madman are releasing Robot Dreams, which
yes.
I did mention a couple of times before. It was the kind of the hit of Cannes at the Cannes Film Festival. MIFF picked it up, played it at MIFF, where it did really well, and now Madman are releasing it. It is I wrote down the synopsis just so I could read it out. So finally, we could actually tell you what it's about. So set in the 1980s, New York City, Dog, a lonely canine, builds himself a robot for companionship. Their friendship blossoms as they embark on adventures and misadventures across the city. From taking the subway to Chinatown to roller skating in Central Park, one summer night, Dog becomes heartbroken when he's forced to abandon Robot at the beach. Will they ever meet again?
Beautiful film.
Beautiful, heartbreaking, heartwarming.
Yeah.
Kind of, yeah, animated film. Definitely worth checking out.
Sometimes animation gets to your heartstrings a lot more effectively than live action.
I'm sure if you want to check it out in HD, because you don't like filthy DVD, I'm sure it would be on a streaming platform. Madman don't hold back with that kind of stuff, and you'll be able to check it out digitally.
Excellent. So that's everything.
That's it. I'm out of breath.
Well
Time
done,
for a nap.
Mate. Well done. Well, until next time, stay physical.
It's Terrific TV Tuesday, the only Tuesday TV segment that drops on a Monday.
Bang.
How about that, Ben?
That's now I don't have to repeat it because I just heard it.
For those that aren't aware, that was live in our cans.
Ben
heard the intro for the first time.
Our antique cans. That's the first time since I created it.
That's right. Hang on. What was it?
It's Terrific TV Tuesday, the only Tuesday TV segment that drops on a Monday.
Boom.
How they get the AI voice to sound like a person? I don't know.
She's amazing.
She's great.
That was just you in that shower you were talking about the other week. You know,
that's right. The
reverb.
I think I might pay someone to redo it again.
Why?
I'll try and get like a guest.
Back when we had the Kaiju beer commercials and we had Clayton Jacobson do them for us.
Yeah. I should have asked Taz Rock. I was like, can you just say this?
No, we should do that. Get in touch with her.
You reckon you would just record this?
If you're listening, Taz. Alrighty, wow. Terrific TV Tuesday. No explanation required.
Right. So what have you been watching this week, man?
Interesting. I haven't watched a lot of television. I do have a show I'd like to just, you know, reminisce about and talk about. But trying to think, the new season of The Bear has just dropped, so I will be getting into that. Haven't got to it yet. So
the new season of The Boys has also just dropped, which I haven't caught up with.
Everyone's bitching about The Bear, though, because they dropped every episode at once, which I thought is what people do on streaming now, and everyone's saying, oh, we wanted it weekly. It's like, just well then watch it weekly.
Watch it weekly. Show have some fucking discipline, and, you whinging bastard.
And then they're saying, oh, but like, if we do that, then we're going to miss out. Like, we're going to get all the goss, and we're not going to be up to date. It's like, well, don't you work from home now anyway? Like, anyway.
Yeah. How hard is it in this modern day and age, how hard is it to not talk to people?
So
it's pretty bloody easy.
One of my favorite Aussie TV shows that I was very, very late to, began with three movies, then became three series, is Jack Irish. And yes. Just want to talk about that. This is the TV show with Guy Pearce. He came back to Australia after he'd broken in Hollywood, maintained a Hollywood career while coming back to do these, which I found awesome. And it started off as three, I guess you'd call them made for TV movies.
Yeah, TV movies. Like they were, like all of the good British detective shows.
Yeah, like your prime suspect, like, yeah, that kind of stuff.
They do them as seasons where you get like six episodes a season, but each episode is an hour and a half.
Yeah, that's right.
They're basically TV movies.
So those movies were Bad Debts in 2012. Black Tide in also 2012, and then Dead Point in 2014, which were great. They were fantastic.
I've seen the first two.
Yeah, I think you'd really love all of it.
Yeah.
And then it obviously turns into three seasons of this show. And it's about a former criminal lawyer who's become a private investigator, and he's an occasional bookie for like a local, a debt collector for a local bookie, played by Roy Billings, who I just love. Like, you know, he's the same in everything, but you got to love him. He's the most lovable Aussie character actor there is, I reckon.
Yeah.
He's cute. but this guy, Guy Pearce's character, is also suffering some major trauma because, as you learn in the start of the first movie, his wife dies a very tragic death. And so he's sort of gone through the motions of grief, and he's now in that I don't give a fuck phase, which is why he's become a debt collector, because he'll go up against any baddie and he just doesn't really care if they kill him. But it's just a really fascinating show. He gets hired sort of per season to look for a missing person or solve some kind of case. But at the same time, he's then got like a new love interest who's played by, Marta Dusseldorp, I think her name is, from A Place to Call Home and Janet King. And
she's in bloody everything. Everything Australian for a while, Marta Dusseldorp was
and
in.
And look, you know, she's not my favourite actress, but she's good in this. And she will shit you because she's supposed to.
Yeah.
The character's not that likeable. But it's got, as I said, Roy Billings, got Aaron Peterson.
I think that's a big reason why I didn't end up going and watch the third movie.
Why?
Because of what happens in the second movie with her. It upset me.
Yeah, well, she kind of...
Because you know my rules.
Yeah, she kind of exits the show in a way and then comes back to sort of just sporadically. Aaron Peterson from Mystery Road, he's fantastic in this. He sort of plays Roy Billings' henchman, if you will.
Yeah, right.
More of a glorified chauffeur, but he also don't give a fuck. Shane Jacobson's in there as one of the detectives.
He looks like he's going to have a heart attack the entire time he's in the show.
Yeah, and they play on that too, because he's always eating a meat pie or something like that, and he's got the heartburn. He's always pounding his chest.
And his face, like it's like...
Beetroot red.
It's like Chris Penn in Tu Wong Fu, Thanks for Everything, Julie Newmar, where you're like, this guy's going to die soon.
Chris Penn in everything, late 90s, you know. And Damien Richardson's in it too, which, you know, this was sort of the last great thing he did. And, you know, he became like one of those conspiracy theorist voices of the pandemic kind of people that I kind of liked following. He had his own podcast and it was fun. But this was, you know, the last big thing he did. And then you've got these three old blokes that sit in the bar. Guy Pearce's character's office is in the back of a pub, and you got these old blokes that just sit there spitting lyrical, shooting shit about the old times. Terry Norris, John Flouse, and Ronald Fork.
I feel like it's very, like they've ripped it off from Get Shorty, you know, when he's got his office, the bookie's office in the back of the barber, and the old guys who just hang out in the barbershop.
Totally.
Like
everyone
needs them.
Yeah. Yeah. And they are great characters. Their stuff is fantastic.
And that's always the thing. Like David Mamet was a big one. If you read David Mamet's book and you watch a lot of his films, there is always like a conversation. I think he calls it like conversations in cafes.
Yeah.
But basically it's just a couple of old guys who always at some point in the movie would just be sitting in the cafe, like having these metaphysical discussions.
But also those kind of characters allow the writers to go and do a little bit racist. Like, you know, in an old school way, you can't say that, you old timer. It's hilarious. Some other people that come and go throughout the show over the seasons, Colin Friel, Steve Bisley, Marshall Napier, Lockie Hume, Barry Humphries, Vince Colosimo, John Jarrett. It's like a huge cast.
Jeez, it's everywhere. It's all the Melbourne boys.
Yeah, that's right. Brilliant writing, like fantastic acting. And yeah, so if you've never seen Jack Irish, I think it's all on Stan. Some of it might be on ABC, iView, whatever the case. It's pretty easy to find. And you can get it on physical media too. So Jack Irish, that's my terrific TV Tuesday drop.
Show. There you go.
What do you got?
Well... Look, I'll start off because I've been meaning to talk about it for the last 3 weeks. I did watch the first new Disney episode of Doctor Who.
Yes.
I did not care for it. That being said, I am not a big fan. I haven't been a big fan of any of the new Doctor Who's.
Not even Chris Eccleston?
No.
No?
Wasn't a big fan of Chris Eccleston. David Tennant, Matt King. I really don't like Matt King.
Matt King?
Yeah. The one with the ginger girl as his sidekick.
Is that his name?
Pretty sure it's...
Oh, you're probably right.
Or Matt Smith.
Matt Smith, that's the one.
Something generic.
Yeah, the one that played Charles Manson in that Charlie Says movie, the Mary Harron movie. Yeah, weird.
Yeah, he's also...
Strange cat.
John Connor?
The Crown. Prince Philip.
He's Prince Philip in The Crown, I've just always found him kind of unlikable. I just don't like him.
Mm-hmm.
But this Doctor, like all these new Doctor Who's, I just find them to be so incredibly try hard.
Yeah.
You know, they're all so impressed with their quirkiness and you're like, just give it a fucking rest. You know, make the Doctor a nerd again.
Yeah.
You know, make it not, why does everything have to be so flashy? And like, I just,
well,
you know.
I mean, it's never been more popular, Doctor Who. So
no.
You
know. And who, look, you know, clearly it's not for me.
Yeah.
I can jump on BritBox and I can watch all the Tom Bakers and the John Pertwees.
You know, I absolutely love one of the few people that does, although it's appreciated, that telly movie they did with the one doctor, the guy from With Nell and I. What's his name?
Oh, yeah, Paul McGann.
Paul McGann, That one I loved, and it had Eric Roberts in it.
Yeah, Eric Roberts is the master.
That was their attempt to, almost like a pilot episode for an American version of Doctor Who that just never worked.
It didn't work.
Yeah.
And
it remained a movie, and I like that one.
But Sylvester McCoy, who was the last doctor, actually reprises his role and dies and comes back as Paul McGann.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, no, that was great. They're all, look, at the time, I remember thinking it's a bit shit. But now I look back and I'm like,
well, that's not
good.
Saying this. I think it's kind of aged well.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah, definitely.
Because Doctor Who's always been hokey, and maybe you and I weren't ready for that kind of hokiness because it was CGI that was done poorly. It wasn't puppets like it used to be.
Yeah, look, it was a thing of its time. Look, I'm nostalgic for the one that I used to hide behind my dad's chair and watch, and the music used to terrify me and like everything. You know, I loved it.
Yeah.
Do I need to watch this version? It's not for me. It's for kids.
It's 5 o'clock. It's scary time.
Yeah. Yeah. There was one or two episodes. There was a couple of episodes with side characters where the Doctor didn't even feature in it that I liked.
Mm-hmm.
And even like the Sarah Jane Adventures or Adventures of Sarah Jane, which is like a spin-off show, I kind of enjoyed more than...
And yeah, Torchwood?
Doctor Who. Torchwood, not so much. I always liked the main...
That was the American attempt, wasn't it?
No.
Wasn't Torchwood the American... He was the American guy and they were like...
He's Canadian, that guy, that Captain Jack, whatever it is. But everyone else in it is all... They're all Brits.
Okay. You know that that Torchwood is Doctor Who jumbled? The word?
No, I didn't know that. Yeah, all right.
There you go.
Because they're like, they deal with the things that he's not dealing with.
Yeah.
I mean, look, I was always, in the original Doctor Who, I was always a big fan of Brigadier, the general who just kind of, lets Doctor Who do his thing.
Mm-hmm.
But, I'd be keen to hear what people think. It is on Disney Plus, which is a big deal for Doctor Who, for the franchise, but I think it also has its downside.
Mm.
But what I did watch, there's a new show... Why has this gone weird? that's really weird. On Amazon Prime, which just, I think it just dropped, called My Lady Jane.
Okay.
Which is it's a British comedy series. The full season is up, I believe. And it's basically a kind of, not the War of the Roses, but all it's like the Henry VIII kind of era, kind of Tudor England kind of thing. But it's like a alternate reality kind of fantasy slash girl power one. It's all told from the perspective of Jane, who is being forced to get married.
Okay.
Though she wants to be a, you know, a healer and have her own independence, but her mother is basically selling her. And it's like, it's a it's kind of a bawdy comedy. There's strong sex scenes and lots of swearing and all that kind of stuff. It's quite entertaining. It does feel like it's 10 years past its kind of, you know, date. Mm-hmm. Like it's all very kind of, you know, right, girls, right. And you're like, I think we've moved on from this where like, like we know, like you don't have to beat us over the head with all men are either devious assholes, sleazers, or idiots, or gay. If they're gay, then they can be smart, but otherwise you can't be.
Anyway.
But, you know, that's just, you know, you get, I got past that pretty quickly. But there are some kind of, you know, British comedy stalwarts popping up. Anne Chancellor turns up. Rob Brydon plays,
he's in too much these days.
Dominic Cooper from Preacher turns up in it. He's like one of the main kind of villains, I guess, of the show. And I can't pronounce her name. May Retires turns up, who I am really digging in the other Disney series, which now what the hell's it called? I can't remember what it's called, but it's I've talked about it on the show before, where everyone has a superpower. And she's the only person who doesn't.
Yeah, and is she? Yes, you have mentioned this before. Yeah.
And like people have weird, like the guy's like a human photocopier, like but he poops out.
Yes.
He shits whatever he
wish I could remember
creates, so he can only create small things. If they try and create two things, it tears his ass apart. And
what was the one you were talking about where she slides down the guy's cock?
Oh no, that's the boys spin-off.
That's the boys spin-off. Yeah.
The university, where she makes herself grow really small, and
that,
he's like,
that image stuck with me. Sorry. Yeah. All right.
Yeah, she jumps all over it and you see it. But it stars Emily Bader, who plays Lady Jane Grey. She's from one of the Paranormal Activities.
Okay.
Not really too familiar with her. But look, it is quite entertaining. No one swears better than the Brits in TV shows. And there's lots of fuck that. like all of the incredulous stuff. There's like, oh, I could go and... but there's a weird... what they've added to it is a supernatural element where there's the regular people who are called a Verity,
right?
Which I think is, for me, feels like it's straight out of not the Hunger Games. What's the other one with
Maze Runner? No.
No.
Twilight, I don't know.
No, it's the other one. It's the other big one. The big three is like Maze Runner, Hunger Games.
Divergent. Okay.
Like a faction in Divergent. And then there are the other
guys. I love how generic they are that we can just sort of do that.
Then there are these other people who can turn into animals. That's they can just at will.
Gotcha.
They can transform into whatever, you know, some of them are just like a field mouse. There's a guy who turns into a goat.
Look, I don't deny this is good, but you'd lose me with that. Like, I don't do fantasy in television very well. Like
it is an interesting theme, but they're like, you know, the regular people are kind of like, you know, there's a faction of like these guys are monsters and must be destroyed, and so they're all being persecuted.
Yep. Hey, look, it's big. Like fantasy television is huge, but it's just not my bag.
I'd rather
drama, crime, you know.
Yeah.
Whereas film, different story.
It's like it's an interesting subplot, but what I find kind of ridiculous about these things is that if you've got an ability that makes you kind of gives you the ability to be a bit better at kicking ass, you aren't the subclass. You get pretty like, hang on a second, we're fucking awesome. I kick your ass now. So, you know, and there's another series on Netflix like Shadow and Bone or something, which is very similar, where you're like, well, once if you've got magic powers, let's stop pretending that you guys are going to be the pissy doormats in the show. But look, that being said, it is pretty entertaining, worth checking out. Cool. I'd be interested to hear what everyone thinks if they do get a chance to see it. But yeah, it's on Amazon Prime.
Awesome,
check it out.
Want to take us out? Go on, press it, do it.
That one,
yeah.
It's Terrific TV Tuesday, the only Tuesday TV segment that drops on a Monday.
Ben, I've watched the new Cyndi Lauper documentary twice in the last week and a half. Let the Canary Sing, it's called. And that's I think that's my favorite Cyndi Lauper song, Money Changes Everything. It's just the best.
Not familiar with it.
It's anyway, I've been on a real Cyndi Lauper binge after watching that doco. The appreciation factor just shot through the roof. I just love what she's about.
How many times have you gone back and watched We Are the World just for her bit? Wow, 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 wow.
Have you watched the documentary about that? It is possibly the best documentary I've seen in the last 5 years.
Yeah, no.
All about that night. It's called One Crazy Night or something like that. And it's all about how it came together. And it's gobsmacking. And she plays a vital part in it because all the way through the recording, because they do an all-night binge. It's after the Grammys and they're going right through to like 7 in the morning. And all through it, there's some distortion in the song, like it got picked up really late. Quincy Jones is like, what the fuck is this? We've been recording for 5 hours and there's this fucking, and it's all her jewelry.
Yeah,
and
right.
And she's singing, it's all cling, clang, cling, cling. She almost fucked it up.
Fucked the whole thing.
Great.
I do love, there is a clip on YouTube of all of them. And then they do the Daylight Come, Harry Belafonte song because they want to go home.
Yeah, that's right. And look, you know, people make fun of Bob Dylan in that music video because he looks like bored out of his brain.
Yeah.
But you cannot help but feel really sorry for him when you watch this documentary because his singing style was not made for this.
Yeah.
And he can't just sing harmony. And it's really heartbreaking when you watch him just feel humiliated in front of all of his peers.
Yeah.
Good stuff. Anyway, didn't mean to talk about that, but that was where the song came from. Yeah. Anyway. On to the interview of the week, Jeff Wadlow. As I said, all these movies, Fantasy Island, Kick-Ass 2, Truth or Dare, Never Back Down, Cry Wolf. This guy's got good stuff.
I've got to watch Never Cry Wolf again.
He also wrote, there's a movie, Prey, back in the day, Bloodshot, that one with that didn't perform too well with Vin Diesel. It was like
I remember that, yeah.
Yeah, it's a weird one. And Nonstop, the Liam Neeson one on the airplane. He's behind that as well.
Oh, I don't know if I've seen that one.
And he's written and directed the Bates Motel TV show, The Strain, Agent X.
He's got full-blown AIDS. Which is like every chance I get, if we're going to mention Liam Neeson. It's not a comedy. He's got full-blown AIDS.
Right after he pissed himself. So, Imaginary, look, this is a new Blumhouse one. I don't know how people feel about this. I know Malzie saw it. She didn't like the start, but she liked the finish. Like, it's a weird one. It is about an imaginary toy bear, like teddy bear.
Yeah.
But this movie really, to me, it's great. It spirals.
Is this going to go well with that new... I can't think of the name, but I think it's on Netflix, that movie about where his son dies, so he becomes friends with his son's imaginary friend, who's a monster.
What is that one? I can't remember.
Is it...
I know the one you mean.
Benedict Cumberbatch?
Oh, of course. It's got a name. It's like a human's name, a short name. I can't remember what it's called, but Harvey or something like that. Anyway.
Yeah.
That's a Jimmy Stewart movie.
I wish it was Harvey.
Yeah, no. No. This one is fantastic, I think. It spirals into sort of its Beetlejuice meets Nightmare on Elm Street, a little bit of Hellraiser in there, which I mentioned in this conversation. Check it out. Here's the talk to convince you to watch it. And if you don't like the sound of it by the end of this chat, then you probably won't be bothered doing it at all. But
Jesus. It's all or nothing. It's all or nothing on this interview.
G'day, Jeff. How are you?
I'm doing well, Glenn. How are you?
Doing really well. I'm so excited to be chatting with you. This is a movie that I walked out of thinking, this is my favorite Blumhouse movie.
Oh, my gosh. That is ridiculously high praise. I don't think it's even close to my favorite Blumhouse movie, but I am beyond flattered. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I mean, it's a movie that I think is full of love, and I get the impression it's made by someone that spent a lot of their childhood wandering the video stores, particularly the horror section. Would that be accurate?
Absolutely. I'm a pop culture fanatic. I love watching movies and TV shows. I collect comic books and action figures. I don't care at all about sports. I'm single. So clearly you're getting a picture of how I spend my time. And all those references show up in whatever I'm working on.
Yeah. All right. Let's talk about that. So how long has the story been with you?
Ooh, that's a hard question to answer. So the genesis of Imaginary is threefold. When I finished Truth or Dare and Fantasy Island, I signed a first look deal with Blumhouse. And... Mm-hmm. Jason Blum called me up and he challenged me to make a sort of a classic Blumhouse movie, you know, family moves into a house, bump in the night kind of story, because, you know, Truth or Dare and Fantasy Island are not those kinds of movies. And I love a challenge. And I had always wanted to make a movie about an imaginary friend because I'm very interested in subjectivity in storytelling. I like the idea of playing a game with the audience, having a dialogue with the audience, saying to them, I'm showing you something. Is it real? Is it not? Well, if it's not real, does it have real consequences? Like, I get such a rush out of that kind of filmmaking and communing with an audience in that way. And then the third point of inspiration honestly came from my co-writers, Greg Erb and Jason Ormlin. I'd known Greg for a long time. I invited them to come into Blumhouse and talk about ideas, and they pitched an evil teddy bear idea. And so all three of those kind of came together and formed this movie. We wrote the script, and we developed it, honestly, for a couple of years, probably right around when the pandemic started. That kind of slowed things down, and it only came together very recently, and I'm thrilled with the movie that resulted.
Yeah, you should be. When I said that I feel like there's a lot of heart in this, I'm guessing, like, what I mean by that is that I feel like this is taken straight out of the 80s and adapted for, like, the now. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about some influences that you had when you were sort of, you know, deciding how it should look and the direction you should take?
I mean, there's so many influences. All we do is talk about our influences when we're in pre-production on movies, you know, pulling art and talking about stories and honestly asking our collaborators what they're influenced by. But for me, I, as a filmmaker, I always try to identify a couple touchstones for a film when I'm working on it. And the touchstones for Imaginary were certainly the original Poltergeist from 1982. You'd be surprised, a more recent film, Guillermo del Toro's Pan's Labyrinth was another significant touchstone for us.
Yeah, that's awesome. I picked up a little bit of it. It might just be me, but a bit of Hellraiser 2 in there. Like,
yeah.
I kind of feel like that descent into hell kind of very, almost, and a bit of Beetlejuice. Like, I feel like the surrealism is, and it's rich and textured, and I love that. And what appealed to me about this is that it sort of teeters in between that PG-13 and R rating. Like, I feel like it's a really nice middle ground, which is my favorite kind of horror. Did you have like a rating or classification in mind as you were writing?
No, you know, the story always kind of drives that. I mean, I never make a movie for a rating. I will create backup plans for a rating while I'm making a movie in case something ends up being too intense and I need to find a way to pull it back. But I didn't have to pull anything back on this film. I mean, ultimately, it is a movie about a child's creativity and the dangers that can result from that creativity manifesting. And I think that keeps a lot of the horror and the tension off camera, which ultimately makes the movie even scarier, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You've directed kids before, and you get a fantastic performance out of Young, is it Piper Braun, I think her name is. Can you tell us about her and what her comprehension of the story was? I mean, she seems very switched on from what I've seen her do in other films.
She is next level. I mean, she is like Dakota Fanning, Drew Barrymore, young Jodie Foster kind of talent. I mean, you know, we saw hundreds and hundreds of kids. I started to despair. I thought, oh my gosh, I'm going to have to like build this performance line by line with some poor actress and just kind of pull it out of her. Then Piper like walks in. She does that scene from the therapist's office, crushed it. I mean, her one take in the audition is as good as the thing that's in the movie. I turned to my casting director. We have an expression, directors. It comes from like old Hollywood. I don't know where I picked it up, but I picked it up. When someone just nails an audition, just nails it, you're supposed to turn to your casting director and you're supposed to say, get them in makeup. And what that means is like it's a vestige from old Hollywood studio system, meaning literally take this actor down to the lot, smack them with some makeup, and put them in front of a camera today. They are that good, right?
Yeah,
and I think I've said that twice in my career. And I said it with Piper. And honestly, I have directed a lot of kids. I think I'm pretty good at directing kids. I didn't have to use any of those tricks with Piper. She is so, as you said, switched on, just a next level talent.
That therapist scene was incredible. And I kept trying to think, is this in camera? Are there tricks here? Like, I felt like a lot of it was in camera.
Oh, yeah. And like, and I'm not going to sell anyone out. But listen, some of the greatest adult actors, you know, they've had long careers. They can do this in their sleep, right? So if it's an easy scene, you know, maybe they show up and they know they'll kind of figure it out during rehearsal and they're not too stressed. Let me tell you something. Every one of my actors who showed up for a scene with Piper Braun, they showed up ready to rock because Piper is firing on all six cylinders on take one.
Yeah, amazing, amazing. So can't wait to see what happens with her career. DeWanda Wise as well, like such great casting here. Like I love what she does. What drew you to her?
So DeWanda had a general meeting with Jason Blum and it went really well. And they, you know, Blum came to me and said, what about DeWanda for Jessica? And DeWanda and I've talked about this. At first I was like, I'm not sure I see it. Like DeWanda brings so much strength to all of her roles and I love her work. I was a fan of her before Jason even brought her up. I was like, but I'm not sure she's Jessica. I'm not sure she's the right fit. And so I met with DeWanda and I told her I was very open. I mean, I believe in being open with all my partners from Jump Street. And she took that in and she said, well, listen, I'm aware of that, but I want to do something different. I want to stretch. I want to grow. This is my take on Jessica. This is how I see her. And the way DeWanda saw her was completely in line with my vision for the character. And I believe ultimately it's all about collaboration. Like I never cast the character, I cast the actor. So when I meet an actor who I think is right for the role, even if it's not exactly what I saw in my head, if I get a feeling, I just go with it because ultimately I want the character to be more than I could have ever imagined on my own. So I love it when someone comes on with a different take or mixes it up or changes my initial idea. And that's what DeWanda did. And she was just such a fantastic partner. She's an executive producer on the project. Every decision that we made, whether it involved her character or not, she was a part of. And I'm so grateful. This movie is as much hers as it is mine.
Awesome. That's so good to hear. I could pick your brain for hours, but we have limited time. I'm going to end with this question. I've read before your philosophy on practical effects and that, you know, I think it's precisely what a lot of fans want to hear from a director. You know, we all prefer practical over digital.
Yeah.
But why do you think so many studios ignore that despite the fact there seems to be a consensus amongst the audience that we prefer it?
They're lazy.
Yep. Excellent. Yeah. There we go.
I mean, it's you know, that's probably the most succinct answer I can give you. It's much easier to figure it out in post. Like, you know, it just gets, it's more expensive, but it's easier. It's harder to figure it out ahead of time, to make choices. But I think the film benefits from the hard work, and not just in the sort of the philosophical aspect that I've discussed before about having a real thing on set that an audience can react to, but also it forces you as a filmmaker to like make choices. Like I've heard stories about huge budget movies where they had no idea what the monster or the alien was going to look like when they made the movie. No idea, yeah. Right? They were going to figure out after the fact. That's not going to work. That's going to just create problems and inconsistencies, and it's going to hurt the suspension of disbelief that you need from your audience. So, you know, you just got to do the work up front, and the film benefits from it.
It sure does. A great Blumhouse film, a great horror movie. Thanks so much for your time. It's been great picking your brain.
Thank you for taking the time to talk to me, and I really appreciate the questions.
Welcome to Bonehead Weekly Fun Size. We are talking about movies, and this is one of those things where I text James and Chad, and I was like, we done this? Because not only are we going to do a fun size, I want to do a whole episode on this, because I had like four or five off the top of my head.
Oh, yeah. No.
I was like, why have we never picked that up? It was laying right there in front of us, but movies with really great openings, where the rest of the movie's just never as good as the opening.
Oh, I didn't
approach it that way.
There's a bunch, guys. There's fantastic openings.
There's two movies, actually. I'm going to do two, because screw you, I can. There's two that came to mind, and it's because they tell a somewhat complete story in the opening scene, and in two very different ways. One's very sad. The other one is full of adventure. That's Raiders of the Lost Ark and Up. Very sad opening, whereas Up is full of adventure.
That Raiders tells a whole story in the openings. I mean, I guess it sets up the character kind of in a whole.
But I mean, he gets the idol, and then when he gets out, it falls apart. But you get to see him do this ultimate action thing. The opening is like a video game in and of itself. So, yeah, those are my two.
Games have been stealing it from it from 43 years.
I mean, yeah, but in all fairness, it stole it from Flash Gordon and Alan Quatermain. And so. Yeah. Turnabout's fair play. those are the two that came to mind when you gave me this topic. So there you go.
When you came up with this idea, one automatically popped in my head, and it's a classic.
Yeah.
I'm not going to do that one because I want to do another one from a really great movie that doesn't get credit for the amazing opening. That
he's going to Taco Bell and ordering the spaghetti.
Lasagna, you some bitch. I got to do the opening of Little Shop of Horrors. Little shop,
you know,
Little Shop of Horrors, little shop, Little Shop of Terrors, oh, look up. It just automatic. I mean, the movie just starts off with that riff, and it has you wanting to jump out of your seat, and then it just doesn't stop from there.
And who doesn't love Jack Nicholson?
No. It's the one time. No, what am I saying? It's one of the times where the new version is way better than the original, in my opinion.
Yeah, there's a few.
Yeah,
and there's examples of where the movie's better than the book.
Yeah,
not usual, but there are.
But yeah, the movie starts as soon as it fades in, it just automatically starts rocking. And it just sets the tone for that movie. And it's just amazing.
Okay. So I have dozens, or at least have a half a dozen. And it's so hard to pick. But here's one I'm going to pick. I was in the summer, it was February 1995. Sitting in the theater, my mom sitting next to me. And it's the opening from Dusk Till Dawn. That opening from Dusk Till Dawn, the two talking, both great character actors. All it is, one shot comes down as the truck goes by. You turn over, there's the liquor store. Go in, cop pulls up. They have a conversation. We learn everything we need to know about them. We learn everything we need to know about what's about to take place. We learn everything where the plot's going. You know that these two people are friends, and then you don't just suspect a thing. And then when he goes to the bathroom, there are the Gecko Brothers.
Yeah.
And
It's
Michael Parks and John Hawks. That's absolutely right, Chad. Yeah. I could not remember the names. I could remember Michael Parks. I couldn't remember John Hawks' name. Two fantastic character actors.
Mm-hmm.
They go to the bathroom. He goes to the bathroom, comes back out. Michael Parks is murdered, unfortunately, because it's one of the best characters in the movie. And they fight and argue. And as they're walking out, you hear bitch, 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 Tarantino at his mm-hmm. bigger brother as the place is going up in flames. Same shot. Drive off, Dark Knight, and as much as I love From Dusk Till Dawn, as much as I love the scenes that will come, as much as I like that there's two different movies, I can't say that the rest of it is as good as that first 10 minutes.
You bastard.
It's just not. It's great. I love the movie. I have the poster.
I think you're forgetting. That's 95%,
and this right here is 85%.
You're going to do the gun, aren't you?
You forgot about the most important special effect in that entire flipping movie. It's called Selma Hayek, and yeah. It holds up every time.
I was going to say Cheech, but yeah, sure. And this has been Bonehead Weekly Fun Size.
More about you than it does about me.
Thanks, Boneheads. Movie openings. It's funny that I wrote an article about movie openings only last week. They've been watching.
Paying attention.
Probably
certainly not to this show, but to other things.
100% coincidence. This is a long show, Ben. This one is really kicking on.
There was a lot of Blu-rays and DVDs.
That's right.
And a lot of TV.
Come back, Jared. All right. So for recommendations to bring the show to a close, I'm going to just whip through mine really fast. I watched it last week. It's a brand new Eagle title called Breakwater with Dilip Mulroney. And this one, like I've said to you a few times, like I feel like there's been a few titles from Eagle. Did I say Umbrella? I meant Eagle.
I can't remember.
Eagle Entertainment. They've had a few what I would call, in terms of the Eagle catalog, a few prestige titles lately.
Yeah.
And this is one of them. It's kind of got a Cape Fear kind of feel to it as well. And it's all about Dilip Mulroney plays a man in prison that's in there for like a life sentence, but he befriends a young guy, makes him a bit of a protege, and that young guy's getting out, and he asks the kid to go and look for his daughter. Seek her out, and doesn't really want him to do anything except break parole to do it, because it's in another state. But then the guy gets there, meets the daughter, actually falls for the daughter, as these things happen in movies. And then all of these secrets unravel when she discovers that the father sent the kid, and then the father's not who he's all, you know, who he makes out to be. And there's so many tangles of the web that come undone. And
it sounds like a Mamet film almost.
It's got a lot of twists and turns. It's a good crime drama. D- Dylan Irwin is good. It's about time we've seen him in a lead role, you know, again.
He's pretty good in Anyone But You.
Scream 6.
Yeah.
Yeah. So look, yeah, look, there's not much more to add, only that if you like those, I don't know what you'd call them, like, they're kind of noir films. It's sort of middle America, kind of, I don't know how you would describe it other than it's a crime.
Southern noir.
Southern noir would be a good way to put it. And if you like
it. Not gothic noir.
Yeah, gothic noir. Southern gothic noir.
Southern gothic, yeah.
Kind of. In fact, the movie that came out last year, Where the Crawdads Sing,
yeah,
has that feel to it. Also, like, and that one in turn reminded me of Fried Green Tomatoes. And each step, you know, between those three films gets darker. And this one is the darkest. And it goes into some really violent territory. And as I said, like, your mind goes instantly back to Cape Fear, the Scorsese version. And that's all I've got to say about it. Breakwater, check it out. It is out through Eagle Entertainment and highly recommend it.
Excellent. Well, funnily enough, I am going to talk about a film that I actually talked about last week because I actually got around to, I got a screener from Umbrella because they announced its release last week.
Yeah.
I got a screener because I was kind of intrigued by, you know, what we talked about, and I watched it and it was fucking great. It is 1996's Thesis.
Yes, we do. And yes, you spoke about
it. We did talk about it last week. Yeah. It is directed by Alejandro Amenábar, who directed Vanilla Sky, the original, which I think the original film is called Open Your Eyes, but then it got remade as Vanilla Sky in the US, and he did Jamon and a lot of stuff with Penelope Cruz and what's her husband's name? Who's in No Country for Old Men, the killer in that.
Harvey Bardem or whatever.
Yeah, Bardem. Yeah. But this, so basically this, and I think I may have mis-explained the synopsis of the film last week because I hadn't actually seen it.
All these people that went and bought it.
Yeah. No, no, no. It's still, it's very similar to what
they're like, hang on.
Yeah. Pre-ordered it. But basically what happens in the film is this, it's like this girl, she's at university in I believe in Barcelona.
Yeah.
Maybe Madrid. And she's doing a thesis on violence in film. And her, one day her professor, the guy who's kind of mentoring her thesis, she finds him dead in a cinema in the university after he's been watching this tape. And so she kind of goes in, takes the tape.
Yep.
But doesn't tell anyone that she's found him dead or anything like that, just takes the tape and kind of leaves. And then she goes home and watches the film and discovers that he's watching what appears to be a snuff film.
Yep.
And then she teams up with this other guy who's a kind of a horror junkie.
It says 8mm written all over it.
Yeah. And then they discover that there's this back room in the university and a series of girls. Amazing. And the girl in the tape was a student at the university. And there's a whole bunch of girls have gone missing.
Yep.
They didn't necessarily know that they'd been murdered, which is why it's not a bigger thing. They left notes saying, I've met someone and I'm just taking off with them and stuff like that to kind of throw everyone off the scent. But yeah, then there's, you know, it kind of detours into this, you know, kind of snuff subculture at the university. Uh-huh. It is fucking great. It was a student film. This was actually his thesis, his graduate film at film school. And it had enough juice in it that
that's awesome.
It actually got a proper release.
Sounds like a cross between 8mm and Dangerously Close.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And maybe Mute Witness.
Mute Witness, fuck.
Unless it's played on SBS before, it has never been released in Australia before.
All right.
Or maybe it played at MIFF that year kind of thing, but it has not been classified here. So no home entertainment release as far as I can tell. So it's definitely one to check out. I think it's coming out in October this year through Umbrella Entertainment. And it will, you know, aside from the physical, it will also be on the old... Jesus.
Yeah, just keep stretching. I'm trying to log into my other computer here.
It'll be on digital. You can't remember your own password.
I can. It's just not working for me because I'm trying to concentrate on the show.
But yeah, so check that out. And that's it.
Okay, yeah, well, this is the wrap up of the show, and I've forgotten what the fucking end song is, so I'm trying to log into my computer so I can pull it up. We've got a song to play to take us out. You just do the sign off, tell people where to go, and I'll keep trying to tap into this.
All right. Well, you've been listening to Good Movie Monday. You can find us on all social medias. Please like, review, tell your friends about it, tell your mum about it. Thank you, dad for the rabbits. Thank you, mother for the rabbits.
Something is wrong with my computer here.
And enjoy the song. We don't know what it is.
Fuck me, dad. There is something wrong with this computer.
I'm sure you'll enjoy it, and it will be up on that Spotify playlist following this episode dropping on Monday. See ya.
It's crowded house. I've been locked out. There's no way in. Fucking hell.